It's great to be here. Thank you for inviting me. I hope we can have a nice and interesting afternoon talking about world order. I picked the subject because I think that the entire discipline of IR, including myself, have been somewhat confused about what's going on in the world after the end of the Cold War. And it seems to me we've had 20 years to speculate about it or more, so we should have some idea about, right now, what world order looks like. But as you know, there are so many different ideas out there about what it might be, and some of them go in different and confusing directions. And I'm going to comment on several of them, but in order to begin all this, let's start with the concept. We should always do that in political science. World order, what is it really? I define world order as a governing arrangement among states. So this indicates that this has to do with the major types of relations that we have between sovereign states in today's world. Why are states in the center of the analysis? Well, I think that accepts a basic realist, if you will, idea about states as the basic units of the international system and the international society. It's states that are the members of the UN. It's states that are the basic entities in that sense. Of course, individuals, people, are ultimately the most important thing. But you should recall that people get most of their rights and their duties, as it were, through membership, through citizenship of states. That is why it is not nice to be stateless, to be without a state, because you have very few options, possibilities, and rights in this world. That is why it is not nice to live in a state that does not function, a failed state, a fragile state, a weak state. So states are the basic units of the international system. Other actors are, of course, also important. There's a tendency in the discipline of IR to make a too strong distinction between the state as the government and the state as society and as the underlying society and groups of people. They hang together, of course, and what states as government do and how they act has a lot to do with what happens in the underlying society, and we should always look at that interplay. So I'm not talking about states in the narrow sense, but I'm sure you get the meaning of what I'm saying here. Point 1B in your lecture here, the Cold War was easier to grasp. I think most of us could, you know, relatively easy say what world order looked like during the Cold War. There was an East-West order led by two so-called superpowers and their respective alliances. There developed a North-South order in context of decolonization, which was organized through the UN. And seen from my part of the world in Western Europe, there was a West-West order organizing the cooperation that began after the war with the Bretton Woods institutions and the European institutions and so forth. But I'm sure you can add that there was also some kind of East-East order, even though that was more coercive than cooperative for quite a while. So the idea is really that the basic dividing lines were not that difficult to see during the Cold War. That's one thing we should say about order. The other thing we should note is that if you look at the idea and the concept and the notion of world order over time, it has been subjected to what you could call rising ambitions. In the bad old days, order was mostly about peace, even peace in a more narrow sense, namely relative peace between the great powers of the system. I mean, as long as there was not war, especially among the great powers, there would be a reasonable amount of order. But if you look at the ambitions on behalf of world order today, they have increased dramatically. And you can see that, for example, in the Millennium Declaration that was adopted by most states in the UN in the year 2000. What does the Millennium Declaration say? It actually says, okay, in order to have a well-functioning world order, we should not only have peace, we should have much more. We should have a possibility of the good life for all citizens on the planet. Now, not only peace in the sense of absence of war, but the possibility for all people to have welfare, to have freedom, to have access to education, to health, to shelter, to security, and so on and so forth. And what the Millennium Declaration says really is that we do not have a sufficiently good world order until that ambition has been met. So you can see the ambition on behalf of world order has increased dramatically over time. So we should have that in the back of our minds when we complain that world order is not going good and there are lots of troubles out there and lots of problems. This all happens on against the background of a sharply increasing ambition on the behalf of what a good world order should really contain. Point 1D, as I already indicated in my introduction, in terms of the present order, there are so many confusing labels. Someone talks about, I'm sure you know who, about class of civilizations. Another talks about end of history. Two other people, Mersheimer and Kagan, talk about the return of history, meaning the return of balance of power competition between states. Another author, Kagan, talks about the coming anarchy, and so on and so forth. That is what I meant with the confusion I talked about in the beginning. Now, I think that all these different analyses point to something that might be relevant. But I also think they all overgeneralize, and when they overgeneralize, they create a false picture and misleading picture of reality. Let me briefly give an example with Mr. Huntington's clash of civilization. His idea is briefly, as I'm sure you know, that world politics has entered a new phase, and that new phase will be dramatically characterized by clashes, by conflict, by violent conflicts between different civilizations in the world. He identifies 7 or 8. And discusses them is especially worried about clashes between the West and the rest, as he calls it, and the rest he's especially worried about Islam and I think also the Chinese or the Confucian civilization. And there have been so many critiques of this view, and I think most of the critiques are quite right. You cannot amalgamate a huge concept of civilization in that way. What it means to be Western today, or part of a Western civilization, is really much more differentiated than it is made up to be in Huntington's analysis. So we should be more nuanced when we talk about different civilizations. But when this happens, of course, it's more difficult to pit civilizations against each other in terms of clashes. It is true that there are radical elements of Islam, but most of the Islamic groups inside Islam are not radical and not really terrorists in any larger sense, and we should take note of such insights as well, including the fact that civilizations, of course, develop and change over time. Huntington has a tendency to freeze a certain picture of a civilization and then say, this is what Islam is like, this is what the West is like, this is what the Chinese are like, and then pit them against each other. So, just, I can't go on with this because I have so much else I want to say. But let me just say that we cannot buy this analysis wholesale. What we can buy, I think, is another version which I would call Huntington Light. And Huntington Light would be the insight that culture and identities play an increasing role in world politics, and that culture and identities may or may not, in combination, or may often in combination with other factors, lead to conflict. Not always, but they can. And we have seen it in ex-Yugoslavia and in many other places, and I think that's quite true and an important insight, but it's not a clash of civilizations in the larger sense. So you see my point. Okay, he has this analysis and everybody thinks that we should run after it because this is now what the world order looks like. And I said, let's stop a while and see if maybe most of it is wrong and a bit of it is right. He has a point, but we cannot buy his analysis wholesale. All these different labels have a point. I don't think anyone hits the mark except me, of course. And I come to my version of order right now. I'm going to talk about the four major dimensions that, in my simple mind, make up the basic aspects of the current world order. The first dimension has to do with war and peace, with power balancing and power politics. It of course comes out of the realist tradition in IR, and it readily admits that this realist tradition speaks to issues that we must include in our analysis of world order. So the first dimension of world order has to do with war and peace. The second dimension I will talk about, I have called the global economy. There is an economic basis, as it were, of world order. This is, of course, what the IPE people, the international political economists, speak to in their analysis, and I think that should go into the picture as well. The third dimension I will talk about is global governance and international institutions, and this is, of course, the issues that are at the heart of various liberal analyses of world order, and I think they belong in the picture as well. How is the institutional aspect of world order developing, and what can we say about that? And then finally, the fourth dimension is a relatively new one. Some would call it the relatively most important one because it is the framework for our existence in general. I have called it the global environment. I want to talk about these four dimensions, and I want to end up talking about what I call a liberal dilemma, because my next book is on a liberal world order in crisis, and I thought I would touch upon that as well. So this is the menu I have for you, and I hope I can complete it in a sufficiently good time for us to have a little time for questions and discussion. But let me begin with the first dimension of world order, war and peace, and then let me start with the good news. The good news, I think, is that war between consolidated nation states are on the road to the dustbin of history. Well, that's a really heavy one for the realists to take in, because they would say it's an anarchy out there and there's no world government and states can always come to clash with each other. And what I'm claiming right here actually goes in the opposite direction. Why? Well, first of all, so is my claim, there is a what we could call security community, a secure, peaceful relationship between consolidated democracy. This is, of course, an idea that goes all the way back to Immanuel Kant. He talked about a peaceful union of republics, and I know that his term of republic is not the same as the present term of liberal democracy. We can't go into that now. Let me just say that security communities between liberal democracies rest on four pillars. One is democracy, because the basic, you could say, a basic item in democracy is really peaceful resolution of conflict. What is democracy if it is not that different groups who have quarrels agree to solve these quarrels and avoid conflict while they do it? Second, it rests on international institutions where states can cooperate and help to get close to each other and solve their problems. Third, it rests on common values. Liberal democracies share a number of basic common values, and I think peaceful resolution of conflict is one of them. And fourth, it rests on interdependence, on the fact that these states are cooperating and integrated with each other to their mutual benefit. So a security community among consolidated democracies, not among all democracies, because in the early phases, I'm going to talk about that tomorrow. This is a commercial for my lecture tomorrow. I'm going to talk about democracy and democratization tomorrow, and I'm going to try to explain why, in the early phases of democratization, democratic openings, you actually tend to have more rather than less conflict. But once democracies are consolidated, they can enter the security community as they basically have done in what we can call the OECD world. Now, I also have to admit that this idea about security, liberal democratic security communities, is a fuzzy theory. It comes out of the liberal tradition, and the liberal tradition has a tendency to stack different things on top of each other and say all these things contribute to a certain outcome. Okay, democracy, interdependence, common values, common institutions, and all this contributes to the good thing, the security community and the peace between democracies. Okay, but that's a fuzzy theory, because how much of this can go away for the security community to sort of come into danger? I mean, principally, we would have to admit that even democracies could become enemies. But how much of this would have to deteriorate? That is not clear in the liberal analysis. And it's not a and it's not an easy question to answer. Let me give you an example. Common institutions are very important. Okay, let's say that a country drops out of the EU. Okay, that's a huge step. They're out of a common institution. Collaboration with the others is now more difficult. But it's still a democracy. So the fact that it's still a consolidated democracy, even if it's not a member, is that enough to be part of the security community. Yes, it is. Okay. But how much is then enough? You see, it's a fuzzy theory. I'm not going to worry about that now. My first point in the good news is that there is a security community among consolidated democracies in the OECD world. My second claim is that while China and Russia and other states out there, of course, are not democracies, they are also not particularly interested in old-fashioned military competition. This is another liberal idea. This liberal idea goes back to Richard Rosenkrantz and other researchers. And the idea is that greatness for a country today does not have so much to do with how much land you control, whether you can conquer others. It doesn't have so much to do with military greatness. It has to do with the best possible abilities to position yourself in a globalized world where you have to cooperate with the others to get the welfare gains that you want. So it has more to do with capabilities in new technologies, with innovation, with capabilities to work with others, than it has to do with old-fashioned military competition. And my claim then is that even China and even Russia, even if they have their little squabbles or big squabbles around some of their borders, and even if they have remnants of military-industrial complexes, they are now basically interested, and you can see that especially in the case of China, they are now basically interested in participating in economic globalization with the rest of us. Why? Because they know that the road to a more stable nation and better conditions for their own people goes via that participation. So they also know that at the end of the day, some of the legitimacy and the strength of these governments will depend on what they can deliver to their peoples, even if they are not democratic, or maybe even in spite of it, because if they're not democratic, they don't have that kind of legitimacy. And then they got to deliver legitimacy in another way, and the way they deliver is not least through economic growth and economic improvement. And thirdly, there's an increasing respect for borders out there. Now, in the bad old days, borders were changed all the time. If you look at the, I know you have a course in international relations history, and if you look at the history of European state making, it was all about change of borders. It was all about the stronger swallowing the weaker and consolidating larger and more competent nation states in the process. But ever since decolonization, after the end of the Second World War, there is in the international society an increasing respect for borders. That means that international society is very conservative when it comes to change of borders. It will change borders only if two conditions are met. One is that there are previously historically legitimate borders that you can point to, and second is that the parties involved in the process agree that there should be a change. If those two conditions are not met, international society has a problem, as you can see in Kosovo and some other cases. But basically, there is an increasing respect for borders. That means that we increasingly have an international society out there, not an international system. States are not just billiard balls smacking against each other. They agree on certain rules of the game. And one of these rules of the game is increasing respect for borders. So that was basically my good news about the first dimension of world order, war and peace. War between consolidated democracies, between consolidated nation states, even those that are not democracies, is on the road to the dustbin of history. Not that it can never happen again. I'm not saying that. But But the realists that claimed, remember that there were major realists that claimed that when the Cold War ended, tension between great powers would reemerge very quickly. You remember John Mersheimer's 1992 article, Back to the Future. What did he say? He said, the common enemy, the Soviet Union, is now gone. What will we see? We will see a lot of increased tension and competition between the old great powers in Western Europe. Have we seen that? No. You remember Kagan's book from our article from 2007, The Return of History. We now see power balancing coming up in a major way, especially in the cases of China and especially in the cases of Russia. And that means that history is returning in the sense that power balancing is now a great item on the international agenda. We haven't seen any of that big time. I'm not saying that old-fashioned power rivalry is totally out of the question. Of course it happens. It happens in the Middle East. It happens in parts of Asia. There are still places where this takes place. But my claim is that power balancing and rivalry as an overarching characteristic of the international society does not apply anymore for the reasons I have mentioned. Ah, very nice. Now comes the bad news. Because this does not mean that all problems are solved, of course. Point 2b in the manuscript. There are still tensions. There are a lot of tensions. One of them is the so-called war on terror. And it is true that international terrorism is a problem. And God knows we've talked a lot about that since over the last decade. But I think it is a problem that has been pumped up to unreasonable proportions by some politicians, especially by George Bush the younger. Now please note that if you take the number of people that have been killed due to international terrorism since 9/11, excluding 9/11, outside of war zones, it's about 300 persons per year. Of course, that is a sizable number, but it's not enough to let international terrorism qualify as a huge existential threat that would somehow come instead of the Cold War and somehow be the new menace to all of us. Yes, it is a problem. Yes, it requires police work and other work, but it is not a new existential menace. And it's been blown up by a number of politicians for reasons that have less to do with the problem itself and more to do with the general agenda that they wanted to promote. There's an interesting guy in the American academe. He's called John Mueller, and he makes all these interesting comparisons, and I hesitate to mention them, but I think you should. If you don't know about them, you should hear a little bit about them anyways. John Mueller says, well, for the average American, it's the risk of being hit by a meteor is higher than the risk of being killed by an international terrorist. And he has more of these. The risk of dying in your bathtub if you fall asleep is higher than being killed by international terrorism. You have 33,000 casualties on the American roads every year due to traffic accidents. I'm not saying that these comparisons are reasonable, but it does put I think the international terrorist problem into a perspective. Now, I know some people would say, yeah, But what if we get another 9-1-1? And what the American terrorism experts say is that we won't get that. 9-1 was a so-called outlier, a so-called special event. And even a very thorough research has not found strong international terrorist groups in the US. The number of Al-Qaeda people in Afghanistan is now, according to the Danish foreign minister's intelligence, down to 100 or less. You must remember that there is a difference between Taliban and Al-Qaeda. It's not the same. Taliban have local ambitions. It's Al-Qaeda that are the international terrorists. There are not many of them left. So, yes, international terrorism is a problem, but it's not the problem that it has been blown up to be. And I think you can see how the problem has already, in a sense, been rhetorically diminished, because Mr. Obama speaks of it in a different way than Mr. Bush did. He wanted a war on terror. He wanted to mobilize all forces against this existential menace. Mr. Obama talks more about police work and talks more about a struggle that we have to go through, but not about a war on terror. So the next issue then, I want to briefly say something about, if I can get my notes right. I'm not sure I can. Hold on. Here it is. The next issue is about weak states and domestic conflict. How are we doing? Okay. Not so good. And here I basically think I want to admit that this is one of the large problems, maybe in terms of violent conflict, the largest problems that we are facing after the end of the Cold War. We have a number of so-called weak states or fragile states out there. Most of them are in sub-Saharan Africa, but they're also elsewhere, Haiti, Afghanistan. They do not have a sound economic basis. They have weak institutions that are corrupt and inefficient. And often they do not have nations that hang together. I mean, they have different groups of people, but they often belong to different ethnic groups, and they do not really see themselves as a coherent nation. How did these weak states emerge? Well, that's of course a long discussion. Some of it is no doubt due to the colonial powers, even if not all of them were colonies, but let's forget about that for a moment. The colonial powers were not particularly interested in development and the good life for local people. They were interested in control and in profits. When the Belgians left Congo in 1960, there were 6 local people with a university education. And 130 students had gone through a 12-year schooling process. That was all there was. So colonial powers have some of the responsibility for this. They did not make in any big way the colonies ready for independence. But of course, you could also say that this is really the local elites that are to blame. And you're right. After independence, some of the local elites were not keen on making development for the people at large. They were keen on filling their own pockets. Some of them still are. Look at Mr. Gaddafi. And there are a number of other examples out there about rulers who've been sitting there for decades and decades, filling their own pockets and supporting their own narrow patrimonial networks, their clans, their ethnic groups, their friends, their military supporters, and paying them off. And so the local elites are involved in this as well. But the international system is also involved in an ironic sense, because in the context of decolonization, a new principle was adopted in international society. And that principle was adopted in the UN in 1960. And it said, no matter how weak a colony is, no matter how unprepared it may be for independence, it should still have independence. Why? Because the institution of colonialism is no longer acceptable. And you could understand that as a principle after the end of the Second World War. The new leading powers, America and the Soviet Union, were not particularly interested in colonies. They would rather have decolonization. So the international system, in effect, underwrote a principle according to which that states would be recognized members of international society, including having seats in the UN, no matter how weak they were, no matter how much they might fall apart, Somalia, Haiti, Sierra Leone, so on and so forth. And there was sort of no other way they could proceed, because they could no longer accept the institution of colonialism. But you should then recall that this is in stark contrast to the European process of state building. The European process of state building, you can call a sort of Darwinian survival of the fittest process. The stronger consolidated and ate up the weaker in the process. But decolonization, you can call a sort of survival of the unfittest process. No matter how weak you are entitled to independence. So there are a number of weak states out there for these reasons. And they will continue to pose problems for the international society. And it's not easy to do something about it. Why? Because this is not a matter of recolonization. The international society is not looking to go in there and take over. When we go in there, even with large resources in Afghanistan or in Iraq, when we go in there, we're looking to go home as quickly as possible, to cut our losses, to lose as little as we can in terms of blood and treasure, of course. But you can see that this leaves a huge possibility of influence to the locals and the insiders and the local elites. So Mr. Karzai in Afghanistan, even he, if he's a rather corrupt man, and we have seen many examples of that, is still the so-called best bet of the international forces. So they keep supporting him. And you can see how the locals, especially the local elites, and even if they want to serve their own interests rather than the interests of the country, have immense positions of power in that situation. Now, tension number four in my point B under point two. Do you still follow me? We're still on the middle of page one. Okay, good. Right. It's called Eruptions, Tunisia and Egypt. And I should have written Libya and other countries in there as well. And of course, we are happy that a number of old dictators in a very short time in some countries have been thrown away from power. But we are also worried where this will lead. We are not at all sure where the situation in Libya will end. We are not at all sure what kind of regimes will come out of the processes in Egypt and Tunisia and elsewhere. We hope they will be more rather than less democratic. But for reasons that I will talk about tomorrow, we also have reasons to be worried about what's going to happen. Where will China go? Now, I put this in to sort of give you an anti-liberal dose of non-optimism. And it's an attempt to go against my good friend, as it were, Francis Fukuyama. Because he was able in 1989 to express liberal optimism in a very precise and elegant way with his thesis about end of history. But in the process, he came to reproduce a piece of liberal ideology. And that piece of liberal ideology is that history always moves in the right direction, you know. There were traditional societies, but eventually they become modern. They might be non-democratic, but eventually they will become more democratic. And when they are a little more democratic, they will become rather more democratic. And at the end up here is someone like us, right? Developed society, how nice, as nice as it gets, isn't it? We have everything, almost. Well, let's talk about that later. But you see, this is the liberal idea process. Everything always moves in the right direction. And I enjoy that kind of liberal optimism. But there's no law built into history that things always move in the right direction. They might move in the wrong direction. More democratic states can become less democratic. More modern states can become less modern. So I get to my point about China. There's no guarantee built into history that China will eventually become a liberal democracy like the rest of us. They might consolidate a new system which combines capitalism with autocracy. It might be some sort of liberalized autocracy, but it will still be non-democratic. So one of my favorite quotes from Isaiah Berlin, history has no libretto. There's no determinism built into history that it will always end in a certain way and always go for the better. So that is one tension that we have to deal with. Ah, that was my first dimension. War and peace. I got to move on a little bit faster. I'm worried about timing. Okay. Let's move immediately to the second dimension of world order, namely the global economy. Now, the good news about the global economy is that almost all nations, I know that there's North Korea and there's Cuba but that would be almost the only exceptions. Everybody subscribes to a capitalist system, and everybody wants to benefit from interdependence. I think that's good news because that gives an underlying consensus in the international society about what the economic system should look like. Of course, there are still varieties of capitalism out there, and we can talk about that. But still, it's capitalism all around, and that's good news in a world order sense, because there's not that tension between different economic systems that there used to be. But of course, all tensions have not been solved. And I mention a few in point 3b. First is that the system is unequal among countries. There is a tendency, if you build a neoliberal world economic order, which is basically based on the power of the market forces, which have open economies that are not regulated at all. You can do all the exchange with everybody else that you want to. What most neoliberals would say to us, that was the way to go in sort of creating strong economies. But these very neoliberal systems are actually systems for the strong. They benefit the economies that are most developed, the most advanced, the most innovative, those that are best able to compete. Why? Because in an open system, those that are most able to compete can get ahead of the others. And you please note that if you take the economic history of development of Western Europe, it was not based, and North America, it was not based on neoliberal open economies. It was more based on mercantilist principles. We will eventually open up to others, but first we have to strengthen our own economies in order to be able to compete. This is the principle of Mr. Friedrich List from Germany rather than the principle of Mr. Adam Smith. And this is actually the principle that has supported economic welfare for quite a while, and growth for quite a while in our part of the world. But what happens now in the neoliberal globalized world? Well, what we are saying to those that want to catch up in China and elsewhere is that you cannot do this. You cannot make copies, especially not of my books, but you can also not copy our medicines and our techniques and our stuff, because you are now in a globalized system and everything should be open, and you cannot give special privileges to your own companies. And that rather goes against the way that economic success was developed in Western Europe and North America, if we look at it in historical terms. So some people, and one of my favorite books is in this relation is a book by Ha Jun Chang about kicking away the ladder. I don't know if you're familiar with it, but what he says is that if you make such an open neoliberal system, those that catch up will have difficulties, and those that are already ahead will get extra advantages. And I think this is one of the tensions that we have in the world economy at present. Another tension that we have is that weak states, the weak states that I just talked about, those in the bottom, they cannot easily benefit from a globalized system. Why? Because they have nothing to offer. They don't have attractive domestic markets. Why should people come in and invest? If companies from here actually come in and invest, who should they cooperate with? Because there's no local business that they can help upgrade. So the idea is that to benefit from participation in a globalized world economy, you gotta have something to offer. You cannot just get development and all the good things from foreign direct investment only. It doesn't work that way. And finally, it seems to me that the system is still crisis prone. It is capitalism, after all. We should not forget that. And we have just had a housing bubble. I have learned already that the housing bubble was serious here. It was also very serious in Denmark. You know it was serious in the United States, and it was serious in Spain and elsewhere as well. We have had a housing bubble, hugely inflated prices of real estate that for various reasons people had access or possibilities of financing because everybody believed that prices would go up and up and up and up. We all know the game. But eventually prices do go down. This is capitalism after all. And eventually bubbles burst because, I mean, I don't know about the exact situation here, but I can say that in my own country, prices were getting up so that my children, my oldest daughter that was going to buy a new house, I mean, they couldn't do that because so-called ordinary people could not buy housing anymore because prices, you know, come up to levels where nobody can buy anymore. And that's when the bubble bursts, and it bursts everywhere. The next thing that burst was the financial bubble. The financial system, and for those of you that want to have a career in finance, listen carefully. The financial system had developed a number of opaque products, products where you could not really have any healthy chance of accessing what they're worth, because they were tied to borrowers way back where there in the pipeline, but these bonds that they had got their money from were divided up so many times in tranches and levels and stuff, so you could no longer see what it actually was that you invested in. And in the financial markets today, you can invest in all kinds of products that are really opaque. It's very difficult to see what kind of value that they represent, what kind of real value that they represent. And all these products, I think, was at the basis for a financial bubble. Same procedure as with the housing. Everybody believed that these products, which they could not really evaluate, no matter how much they were, how big experts they were, everybody believed they would go up and up and up, but they wouldn't. And some of the large financial houses in the US broke down. And a lot of countries, including my own, had to come in and bail out the banks. So what we have now is a temporary solution to the financial bubble, but what has it created instead? It has created a new sovereign debt bubble. That is to say that countries who have undertaken these rescue operations are now increasingly indebted themselves. Look at Greece, look at Spain, look at Portugal. Who's next? I don't know, but it's not going to look nice, and these tensions are not easy to repair. We go to page 2. So, the good news is that capitalism is not in a mortal crisis. It will go on. You don't have people out there shouting that we want another system, we want socialism instead, or something like that. It's not that. But my worry is, I really have three worries. One is that capitalism in our part of the world has become more and more speculative, more and more orientated towards financial products, the value of which we have difficulties in understanding and ascertaining. If you look at the American economy, the value of finance has gone up, I think, from 9% to 18%. In a very short span of years. Whereas so-called real products, you know, things that people can, clothes and cars and stuff and things that we can use, are more marginalized. I'm worried about that development in Western capitalism. I'm also worried about the unequal capitalism in the modernizing countries. There are simply too many lousy jobs in China and elsewhere. And because there are so many lousy jobs, I think we pay too little for our running shoes and a whole lot of other stuff. And we have to pay more, and that imbalance has not been corrected. And finally, of course, as I mentioned, I'm worried about the weak states, because formally they are part of the globalized system, but really they don't really participate in it to their benefit. Okay, I'll speed up. Let's go to point 4. A third dimension of world order, global governance, international institutions. The good news, we now have a vast network of universal, special, regional institutions. Most states want to cooperate for the common good. As I've said several times, we have an international society out there that respect common rules rather than an international system of billiard balls. But there are also problems and tensions, of course, as you will know from what I've already said. There's not really an institutional setup in place to face the economic crisis. Now, I consider this really ironic. We have a world where the economies are increasingly very, very closely integrated. But what we have found out in the course of the financial crisis is that this integration has not been accompanied by a regulatory or a governance level of cooperation that had an apparatus that could be set in, that could really do something when this crisis broke up. We have something called the Basel Committee. I bet you can't say who's member of the Basel Committee. But the Basel Committee is an obscure entity down in Switzerland somewhere who makes bankers' rules. And very slowly and belatedly, and they are not enough to it's not enough of a system to face the economic crisis. So ironically, this crisis, which has demonstrated how close we hang together economically, this crisis has to be met basically by single countries. American rescue packages, French rescue packages, German packages, even the EU, you can see that today, has troubles in cooperating for the common good to this. So there's a sort of tension between the actual economic integration and the lack of a governance framework which can actually do something about this integrated substance when it comes into a crisis. Same thing with I think the weak states. There's not really a setup to face weak states. I mean, basically the international society is resting on the principle of sovereignty. Sovereignty means that states have a right to non-intervention. They have a right to say, as for example the Chinese often do, that you should not interfere in our affairs because we have sovereignty. But at the same time, the international society is well aware that sovereignty sometimes means that some of these states will not do good for their peoples. They would rather, they get into conflict. And when they get into conflict, there can be humanitarian disasters, as there was in Germany, as there was in Rwanda, as there has been in Sudan, as we see now in Libya. What is the international society going to do about that? We can do very little if we should fully respect the principle of sovereignty. For that reason, international society adopted a new principle in 2005. The principle is called responsibility to protect. And I'm sure you are familiar with it, but it does say that if there are really big humanitarian problems in any state, and they cannot be faced by that state, the international society has an obligation to step in. Because, I mean, humanitarian disasters have to happen before you can do something about them. That means there have to be bodies on the table. Rwanda, Libya, Sudan. They have to come in, they come in too late, they come in with too little. Because they will not devote sufficient resources in terms of materials and manpower. And it's not at all easy to plan for this and to do it in an efficient way. So it's difficult to face the problem of weak states for international society, even if it is in principle interested to do so. Point three, American unilateralism still in play. Well, it was quite clear under Mr. Bush that there was a sort of a clear American unilateralism, but that was also in some ways present under Mr. Clinton and is still present under Mr. Obama, but the rhetoric has of course changed dramatically. But America still wants to be number one and still wants to basically run the game. And that might create tensions, perhaps especially together with the next point, a kind of Western unilateralism as well. That is to say, Western democracies prefer to work together on their own and to leave the non-democracies on the side. They're not legitimate anyway. And I get the point. It goes a piece of way. In that sense, democracies are more legitimate in the sense that they represent their peoples. But if world problems should be tackled only by consolidated democracies, a large number of states and peoples would also be left entirely out of the picture. So there is a legitimacy problem in that sense of the word as well. So some people say, okay, the way to confront this is really to make a more efficient UN, and a good part of the way I would agree. But you know how difficult it is to make a more efficient UN. They've talked about that for 18 years. Now, everybody knows that the membership of the Security Council should be sort of revised so that it could live up to today's world rather than the world of the late 1940s. But there are a lot of vested interests involved. And those countries that stand to lose from such a process are not particularly interested in going into it. Some people also say that there should be reform of the G20. You know, the G20 is a sort of informal institutions. They don't have rules. They don't have any sort of set framework. They just meet and settle things. And normally, of course, most of the time, the few larger countries lead the way. But in order to have an efficient G20, we should really have members who were, to some material extent, representative of the regions that they come from, so that we could be sure that this was not just, you know, a few countries that were meeting, but that this was a meeting of all the major regions and countries in the world, and they should be more committed to do things. But again, this is very difficult. China and Russia, I think, underline sovereignty and non-intervention in a world where behind the border issues are of increasing importance. If we want a world where workers should not be poisoned, and the environment should not be put to pieces or destroyed, we need some common rules that everybody will submit to. In order to have everybody submit to rules, everybody also have to submit to control and inspection. Otherwise, they might cheat. We don't want them to do that. Well, if they should submit to control and inspection, they cannot totally go on with sovereignty and non-intervention. So you see, in a more integrated world, there are more and more behind the border issues that require common cooperation. And those behind the border issues are difficult to face if the leading countries keep emphasizing a principle of sovereignty and non-intervention. And where that will go, I'm not sure, but I think tensions in this area will be increasing. Will an eclectic approach be sufficient in a globalized world? I'm not sure. As I said, in a number of areas we lack effective governance, we need it, and the longer we don't have it, the more problems will pile up. Now, don't worry, I'm closing shortly. Point five, the fourth dimension of world order, the global environment. The good news, I think, about the environment is that there is increasing awareness of the environmental problems that we all face. I also think it's a good news that there is increasing willingness, at least in principle, to cooperation, to chip in, to face the problems. But I also think that there are serious tensions, because we still have a large discussion about how serious the problem really is. You know, I have an old colleague in my Department of Political Science. I'm sure you know his name. It's Bjorn Lomborg. He's now an environmental optimistic guru. So he's had no time to work in my department for quite a while. He's traveling around the world with an optimistic message about, you know, if we pull ourselves together and apply some modern technologies, we can face these problems. And some people will say we can't. It's much worse than that. We have to change our lifestyles. We have to do a whole lot of things. And he will say, no, that's not true. That's just rubbish. And the reason why this discussion can go on is that the environmental problems are so diverse and differentiated and complicated that they're very difficult to put together in one jar and then decide about how serious they are. Let me read you seven problems. Population explosion, CO2 levels in the atmosphere, destruction of the rainforest, polar sea ice loss, collapsing fish stock, ocean dead zones, mammal extinction. Now, put those together in a jar and tell me how serious is the environmental problem in all these respects. It's not so easy, is it? And we might have discussions about it. And for that reason, it is difficult to get real action underway. It seems to be coming, but there is still lack of, I think, serious commitment among some of the leading states who would rather sit back and see what the others do. And many of the modernizing and developing countries want the others to pay, want the rich countries to pay and go in a sort of blame game. And the guarding of sovereignty is also an element here. Who's going to pay? So, that was my four dimensions. I want to re-emphasize that there was actually a lot of good news. War on the road to the dustbin of history, all subscribed to a common capitalist system, global governance, international institutions, discussions, and increasing awareness of the global environment. But as I said, there are also a number of tensions that we have to face. And before finishing, let me just briefly indicate one of the things that goes into all this, and it's something that I call a liberal dilemma. It's mentioned under point 6. We have a world order which is more liberal than ever before, but what should liberal democracies then do? Should they be very activist in promoting liberal values, lead the struggle against Gaddafi and other dictators? Or should they respect sovereignty and non-intervention, leaving that problem to the Libyans? These are complex practical issues, but they're also connected to the two different dimensions in the liberal concept of freedom. That concept has a moderate side. Freedom is leaving others alone, self-determination, respect for other values than our own. Sort of moderation, let the others be, let them do what they want. But the liberal concept of freedom also has an activist side. There are universal values which are relevant for everybody. Liberal democracies should therefore actively seek to promote these values of freedom of speech, organization, and so on. To bring freedom to all dictators who stand in freedom's way, we must bring freedom to all, and dictators who stand in the way of freedom must be removed. So you can see that the liberal idea of freedom has a very moderate, empathetic, respectful side, which says non-intervention, you choose your values, I choose mine, we can talk, but basically you do what you want and I do what I want. And then the liberal idea of freedom also has a very activist side. We have certain values. They are universally relevant for all. If you don't want them, we will stuff them down your throat because they are relevant for everybody. This is what it says in the American National Security Strategy of 2002. There are certain values which are true for everyone. And you can see, if you're very activist, you can become a liberal imperialist. I know what is good for you. You don't know it yet, but I will tell you. And you see, and this is what happens in Afghanistan and Iraq and elsewhere. So it's really a huge dilemma. The Danish cartoon affair was an aspect of this. A Danish newspaper said, we have these values that Muslims must learn, and we will stuff them down their throats. They need to be scorned and ridiculed like the rest of us, because this is what freedom of expression is all about. And you had the American newspapers who said, yeah, we know all that, but you don't have to use your freedom of expression to everything. And you don't have to pick those fights with these people because that might not be necessary. So let's just be tolerant for a while and see if we can talk. You see? So too much activism can lead to liberal imperialism. Too much moderation will sometimes leave dictators alone. And I think liberal states sometimes have problems in fighting their feet in this respect. So when I sum up the four dimensions, what I get is actually a relatively decent world order if you look at our part of the world. Relatively decent democracies, decent cooperation. Yes, we have crises, I know that. And we face all kinds of economic, environmental, and so on. But still, I think, terrorism and so on. But I still think it looks doable to me. But if I look at the so-called other half, I'm more worried. What does the current world order have to really to offer the some 500 million Indians that are under $1.25 per day? What does it have to offer the Chinese migrant workers? What does it have to offer the population in the weak states in sub-Saharan Africa, or good parts of the population in the Middle East, for that sake? So there's a sort of split there that I'm still worried about. And between these tensions, you have to make up your mind about, your own mind about world order. Thank you very much.
So it's more an economic topic. You said from the point of view of history of economy, lagging countries have little chance to catch up with the leaders. And Lithuania is in a periphery. And I don't know, is it really specific? Yeah, Lithuania. And how do you see it, the perspective for countries in periphery? Because I still think there's some good examples. Maybe there are exceptions like Ireland or Asian tigers.
Yeah, thank you for that question. It takes me to admit that if you have to give such a relatively brief talk about world order, you have to sometimes overgeneralize, because it's not that I think that all possibilities for modernizing countries are shut out. What I do think is that, or what I think is demonstrated by history, is that most of those countries that we now look at as successes, including the East Asian country, including the tigers in East Asia, did not do that or did not make that accomplishment by neoliberal means alone. It's not that they were autarkic or mercantilistic in the radical sense. They did not shut themselves out of the world market entirely. They wanted to integrate and cooperate. But they were from early on, Taiwan, South Korea, aware that if they were going to be competitive in the long run, they had to build up their own economic force and strength. And they used, and they were successfully using, foreign investment for that purpose. And now the claim by some of the critics of the current, what you could call market-driven neoliberal globalization, is that the possibilities of doing that are narrowing down because more and more rules are being set up that prohibit states to do that, that prohibit states to give temporary special advantages to their own companies, that to give them or to demand from foreign investors that they should cooperate with locals and that they should integrate locals. That, so you have a tendency in the current context of neoliberal globalization which sort of works against the successful instruments that these countries were able to use. And this is what then some people call kicking away the ladder, because then it might not be impossible for them, but it will be more difficult. And the bottom line for each country that wants to catch up and modernize, it seems to me, is to be skeptic about the extent to which this can be driven by neoliberal market forces alone. Now, 1 minute more, because I think that to some extent Ireland is an example that also proves the point in a negative way, because Ireland was fortunate to take in a lot of foreign investment at an early point. They gave them very good conditions in free zones and very low taxes, and a lot of that investment was then driving a relatively long-term upswing in Ireland. But now comes the day of reckoning, and what we have then seen is that Ireland has really missed building up its own strength in this whole process. It cannot sufficiently point to Irish sectors of the economy that are, which are now able to better compete in a globalized world. That leaves them dependent on two things. One is foreign investment that might go elsewhere, including to Eastern Europe, because they can get cheaper wages there. This is already happening to some extent, and the other is that they have to a large extent relied on a housing bubble, and that bubble has now burst. So I think some of these examples prove the point that I'm saying, but I was probably over-dramatizing a little bit.
Like a lot of people know, China is becoming a major player in the world politics. Some say that even the most important player. And when this situation occurs, is it possible that Tibet will gain the major player in the world politics, and is it possible that Tibet will gain independence? And the second question would be, what position of United States of America will have in this new age of world order?
As far as independence is concerned, it seems to me, like I said, that the international society is so very conservative. It will not easily tolerate a large number of new countries. Why? Because I think it has negative experiences with it. It can lead to genocide, it can lead to conflict, it can lead to a lot of bad things. Anywhere that that contemplation is underway, that a new country is accepted, the international society is always worried about the consequences, about the larger consequences. So I do not think that we will see a brave new world of many more new countries. And I think that the international society will stay conservative and very inactive in terms of accepting new countries. And I think that the major road that will then be chosen is one of higher degrees of local autonomy within given nation states. And that can, of course, go very far, so that you almost have de facto independence. But in most cases, it will not go that far. You can see how the international society does not really know what to do or how to do it in terms of Kosovo. There's a problem too in terms of East Timor. I think there's a problem in terms of British Somaliland, which is basically an autonomous unit of Somalia, which is relatively well functioning and which many people think should be recognized. But you can see how the international society still holds back. Now, I hope that was an answer to one of your questions. The other question was about, can I take 2 minutes more? Okay. The other question was about great powers and the coming role of the United States. And this is, of course, a big issue, because immediately you think about the competitors and how strong the competitors are. And my immediate feeling is that the current strength of China is being relatively dramatically overestimated. There was an article in The Economist a couple of years ago which said that the Chinese gross national product was overestimated by 40%. Why? Because they used two old PPP, purchase power parity measures, for calculating it, and when they updated their PDP measures and took inflation into account, their gross national product would go down. And I also think that many people forget that China has a number of problems related to the countryside, related to their environment, and related to the function of their system in a larger sense, even if they should move in a slightly more democratic direction, which will keep them preoccupied for quite a while. So you see, I don't think they will be major global players for a while. They are now players in Africa, and they will be players elsewhere due to their investments. But I don't see them as major global players, and some sort of by default, that would strengthen the position of the United States.
The point of departure is your last conclusion, actually, on too much or too little liberalism. And I was wondering, so how to make a world a better place? And I know it's a very complex question, a tricky question, but what should be the very first steps to start with? And I know that we are all, in a way, living in a Western society, are trapped by our liberalism and our democratic ideals. And if we follow, say, the idea of constructivism, how we should construct a better vision, where should we start with, and how should we feel, or start feeling ourselves in someone else's shoes? Thank you.
Oh, thank you very much. That is indeed a billion-dollar question, and I'm not sure I can answer it to either your own, neither your own or my own satisfaction. What I do know that if you look at the discipline of IR, we have a discussion there which is a never-ending discussion, which is about which community is the most important community in the world. Is it the community of mankind at large, or is it basically the community of your nation, of your state? And depending on what answer you give, your political plans for making this world a better place, I speculate, would look different. What I can say analytically is that if you look at the historical developments, it has mostly and always been, or most always been the case, that states, and I sympathize with that, that states seek to take care of themselves first. I mean, the principle of sovereignty is not only a right, it is also an obligation. It is an obligation to take care of yourself. You might fail in that. That is why we have failed states. But this obligation to take care of yourself, I think, is obligation number one. Why? Because if we fail in that, we would create problems not only for ourselves, but also for others. Now, secondly, once we have taken care of ourselves, and we can, of course, discuss how far that should go, how rich, well-fed, and prosperous should we be, but once we have done that, we can speculate about spending and speculate about how much we should spend of our resources in helping the rest of the world. And again, if you look at it analytically instead of normatively, you can see how much rich countries have been willing to invest in a way in other people in the world. For instance, in deciding how much they want to spend on development assistance. And you know the UN for some time think that we should get to 1%. Now I think it's lowered a little bit. But very few countries, Denmark prided itself at one point, but we're below again. Very few countries get to 1% of GDP. And I think that is a material indication about the way we divert our resources internally and externally. Because you have to think, in my country at least, how many resources, how much of GDP is used for internal redistribution from the rich to the poor? I would say 30 or 35%. This is a whole lot, you know, via the tax system. We have a universal welfare system, and people are then taken care of. So you see, there is a huge willingness to support taking care of you and yours. There's also a willingness to help the rest of the world, but it is much less developed for a lot of reasons that we can talk about. Now, do I have problems with that? Yes and no. On the one hand, I sometimes think we do too little. We could do more. We talked about these humanitarian disasters. We should be more ready to do more. But I cannot imagine a situation where the 1% would become 30 and the 30% would become 1. So in that sense, we live in a world where we take care of ourselves first. And for some of the reasons that I've talked about, I think it has to be that way. Yeah.